I really appreciate the opportunity to once again be back here in order to talk to constituents and friends and business people and residents. I'm excited to learn about our new lactose ice cream enterprise here in Roscoe, and looking at opportunities all over Sullivan County. It's also great to be back in Sullivan County because, as you know, we had a contentious election a few months ago, and I was very pleased that I carried Sullivan County by about 2,000 votes. So that was really great, and we worked hard at it, and I had a lot of great local support, and I truly appreciated that support. The first 50 days in Washington have been very interesting, and I apologize if there's occasionally a barrier in the way there. I see Eric, and now I don't see Mike. Okay. But the first 50 days in Washington have been interesting, to say the least. The new administration is getting itself up and running, and obviously there have been some bumps in the road. We can talk about that. But I'm really, frankly, I'm not going to talk very long at this particular juncture. I want to tell you a little bit about what I've been doing, but really want to hear from you, hear your questions, and hopefully I can satisfy you with answers, or if you're dissatisfied, at least you've heard what the answer is. I've been appointed to the Budget Committee, the House Agriculture Committee, and the House Transportation and Infrastructure Committee. Budget does not have subcommittees. You are responsible for the budget resolution. We expect the president to submit a budget to us in the coming weeks. The new budget director, who is also a former congressman from South Carolina, was just confirmed by the Senate last week, and so he is getting up and ready. And we had a hearing or presentation from the Congressional Budget Office about 3 weeks ago. And the presentation basically said within 10 years, the national debt of the United States is going to go from $19 trillion to about $29 trillion if we don't change direction. And the biggest issue in my mind is lack of economic growth, because if you get more growth in the economy, you will generate more tax revenue to the government, and it does tend to ease a multitude of issues and financial problems that we face as a nation. But a critical thing here is that we cannot be the generation that leaves our children and grandchildren with a much less prosperous, a country with less opportunity than what our parents and grandparents gave to us. So that's the Budget Committee. That we have had some hearings on the ACA in the Budget Committee. We've also had some hearings on just generalized economic forecasts. So we can talk about some of those issues as well. The Agriculture Committee, I am really pleased. We've had two hearings so far in the Agriculture Committee, one on the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, also known as food stamps, the SNAP program, and whether or not we should put restrictions on sugary beverages under the food stamp program. We now purchase, according to the testimony last week, and we had people from the Brookings Institution and the American Enterprise Institute, among others, we now purchase approximately $6 billion a year of sugary beverages. That includes fruit juices, and $3 billion of that is soda. As I said during the hearing, when we had soda when we were growing up in our house of five kids, we only had soda when it was someone's birthday party. But we never routinely had it because my mother just didn't believe in it. So this is an issue, and the question that we can discuss this. The question is whether we should put a restriction on that kind of purchase, or whether we should first do a study to determine whether or not you can actually change the dietary habits of people if you put such a restriction on. So I think we may be heading in the study direction. I'm also on the Commodities Subcommittee, as well as the Nutrition Subcommittee on Agriculture. On the Transportation Committee, I'm on the Highway and Transit Subcommittee. I'm on the Public Buildings Committee, which is actually has some interesting twists to it. But also I'm on the Rail Subcommittee, for which I'm the vice chairman of that subcommittee. And so rail transportation is a big issue in upstate New York, and so this is an issue that I hope to be working on. The big issue that I anticipate coming through the Transportation Committee And my friend here was raising issues about organized labor, etc. A lot of folks want to have an infrastructure bill. This is an area where President Trump and Democrats and Republicans on the Hill will probably find a lot of agreement. The question is, how do we pay for it, and what is the means of financing? And my approach on infrastructure is going to be to say, we should not reinvent the wheel. We should not try to create new programs like Startup New York, like they did in Albany. What we should do is invest, if we have the resources, invest in the existing funding streams, highway, bridge, transit, that all the localities and the transportation authorities are aware of. But we should also invest in things like the Water and Sewer Revolving Loan Fund in Albany. There is a backlog right now of over $2 billion worth of water and sewer projects that can't be funded because there's not the resources, or the locality simply is at their statutory debt limit and they can't afford even a 1% interest loan from the Environmental Facilities Corporation. So what I would like to see is not reinvent the wheel, but to fund the existing programs that the localities, the mayors, the counties, all of these jurisdictions, as well as the environmental lawyers and consultants, understand what they have to do in order to achieve funding. And there are also some projects of national significance that it doesn't directly affect us in the 19th district, but actually it does. If you ride the train from south of New York City to north of New York City, you may have heard that the so-called Gateway Project needs to be funded and built. This is a two-tunnel system to carry the Amtrak underneath the Hudson River between New Jersey and New York. The existing tunnels were severely damaged in Superstorm Sandy, and engineers regretfully tell us that the existing two tunnels between New York and New Jersey have a useful life of between 10 and 15 years. And that is really significant. So one of the things we've got to do is we've got to find a source of funding for Gateway. And I've met just this past weekend with someone who's in municipal finance talking about innovative ways in which we could try to fund that project, but also do it in a way where we expedite the design and the environmental reviews, because we can't wait 15 years designing a project like that when the existing tunnels may not have a useful life that long. So we've got to expedite those design and planning reviews. And I think that's an area where you're going to find a lot of symmetry and a lot of agreement among Democrats and Republicans on the infrastructure committee to try to expedite such projects. What I've been doing around the district, frankly, I've been meeting with a lot of groups, individuals, every single hospital administrator, every health plan administrator, people that are involved in not-for-profit organizations, people that are involved in the insurance business, people that are brokers for small businesses and local governments. I met just with yesterday morning with a firm that is a very large insurance broker for a multitude of school districts and local governments, as well as small businesses all throughout this region and upstate New York, and to talk about the ACA and what we need to do. My approach on the ACA is to say we should preserve what works and fix what doesn't. I have not subscribed to this repeal mantra, repeal and replace. I'm also somewhat concerned that we not repeal, as some of my colleagues want to do, repeal all of the revenues that were created through the ACA, because we're going to have to fund a replacement. They fund premium support for people on the exchanges if they're income eligible, and I expect that that's going to be changed to a advance refundable tax credit, but you still have to fund those things. And we also have to fund a transition on Medicaid, which is a big issue for New York State, and it's a big issue for all of our counties. I am very much bound and determined that we will use this process over the next 2 years, and this stuff is going to take at least 2 to 3 years to fully roll out, that we use this process over the next 2 to 3 years to finally repeal what I call Nelson Rockefeller's worst mistake as governor, which he imposed on the counties and New York City. He imposed a significant portion of the state's Medicaid costs on the local property tax. Now, I'll throw two numbers out at you. $9 billion is the entire amount in all the local governments in the United States of America pay for the local share of Medicaid. $7 billion of that $9 billion is paid by local governments in New York State. $5 billion is New York City, and New York City has an income tax to pay for their share of Medicaid. So candidly, I'm not as concerned about that. I'm more concerned about the $2 billion that comes out of county property taxpayers that in virtually no other state in the union do we require this. And this was Nelson Rockefeller's single worst mistake as governor. Just because we've lived with it for 51 years doesn't mean we should continue to live with it. I researched this when I was running for my election, and in fact, I read the Medicaid statute. The Medicaid statute permits a state to impose a local share. So what I would propose is we give the state a 3-year period to plan for it, but over that 3-year period, we repeal the ability of a state to impose this local share and force Albany finally, after 51 years, to do what it should do, which is to take the responsibility for Medicaid. Couple of other issues I'm working on. A number of our hospitals have issues with how the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services, CMS, how they determine the area and the region that they're in. It's a very complicated issue called the Medicare Wage Index, but this really hurts the hospital up in Kingston, where their reimbursement for the exact procedure is 25% less than the hospital across the river in Dutchess. And this is also an issue for the Hudson Hospital at Columbia Memorial, where they are very much disadvantaged by this. This is a very complex, complicated topic to argue at the federal level, but it's an example of the kind of issues that we're getting into. Lastly, I just want to give you greetings from Chris Gibson. I saw him last night walking his dog in Kinderhook, and I asked him, because I had heard of the new National Security Advisor that the President just appointed yesterday, H.R. McMaster, and everything I'd ever heard about this guy has been extraordinarily positive. He's a PhD in military history. He was a leader in the counterinsurgency movement, and I talked to Chris about it, and he said, oh yeah, I served under H.R. McMaster in Talifar in the counterinsurgency we did in Anbar province, and he said we could have no better person. So I know from my vantage point, we have a lot of issues around the world. We have a lot of problem and hot spots for the United States. Perhaps we need to have a more modest foreign policy in some regards, particularly in relation to military exercise. But at the same time, we need to make sure our military and our intelligence is second to none. And H.R. McMaster is someone who I think, as National Security Advisor, should give some comfort to people that we have an absolutely sterling 3-star general in that position. Someone asked me, have we had generals in that position before? Yes, we have. Brent Scowcroft, who was highly regarded under the first President Bush, and Colin Powell was also an active military officer when he served as National Security Advisor. So it's not unprecedented. So it is, and I have to tell you, every single day, and someone told me during the transition, a former Democratic congressman from Cape Cod, Bill Delahunt. I went to Harvard for the only time I ever got close to Harvard, by the way. And I went to Harvard for a 2-day seminar during the transition that they give for Democrat and Republican new members of Congress. And it was really a fascinating and eye-opening experience. It was a great opportunity to meet new colleagues on both sides from all across the country. And Bill Delahunt said one thing. He said, if you ever lose the absolute thrill of walking into that Capitol every day and representing your district, then you know it's time to leave. And I can tell you, I am thrilled every single day when I walk there. I am humbled by the opportunity, and I'm humbled also by the responsibility that I have to listen to people and try to represent them as best I can. And that's what I've been trying to do. And my wife, this is a very different experience for us because we've been married 36 years, if you can believe that, and she's now taken to calling me a weekender. which in Columbia County, maybe in Sullivan County as well, in Columbia County, that can either be a term of endearment or a term of disparagement. And I'm not sure which she means as certain times. But it is really a thrill and an honor. And with that, I'd be happy to try to respond to any questions that you might have. Steve.
Before we start the questions, I should have said this before. I want to introduce Jacob Billig from Billig, Laughlin, and Silver. They sponsored the event this morning.
He paid for the breakfast.
He paid for the breakfast.
Hey!
If anybody had a problem with the breakfast, George, no, he's the diner. He's the cook. He's the cook. Take it up with him. Let's start with the questions. Again, single question, no speeches.
Judy. Good morning.
I'd also ask you to identify who you are and what business or entity you're from.
Judy Balaban. I own Wellness Home Care. We're a licensed home care agency for over 30 years. And my question is about the Affordable Care Act. I've listened to you answer some questions on the radio, and my concern is really for the working poor. I have a son who has insurance through the Affordable Care Act. He has a tax credit, so his monthly premium is under $100, which is good because he could not afford more and he has high blood pressure. I have not heard anything that will address the needs of the working poor. A health savings account is not going to work for him. Advanced tax credits is not going to pay for his premiums. And I'm asking what the plan is for those millions and millions of people who are not going to be able to be insured.
Good question. Judy, does your son, is he in a so-called one of the metal plans? Is he in a bronze or a...
Yes.
He's in a bronze. And he receives the premium credit to help him pay for his monthly cost of that.
Renny is a very low deductible. It's
right.
An excellent plan, as well as my partner has a similar plan.
Yeah.
You know, there and Sullivan County, we're the second poorest county in New York.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not as if those costs for their health care are going to go away. You know, it's just going to be absorbed in a way that they're going to become more ill.
And let me ask you one other question. Who is the insurer that he gets the plan through?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
Because he's doing that independently.
Okay. So here's what my position is on this topic. I think that There are things about the ACA that I think have worked well. We've added people to insurance that previously didn't have coverage. We've lowered the rate of uninsured in New York to about 8%, which is pretty good. And we've also made sure that pre-existing conditions are paid for and covered, and that someone can't be tossed off. Although there were rules in New York State already on the pre-existing stuff, because I voted for those years ago when I was in the legislature. So I think the idea of the change for someone like your son would be, I think it would almost be imperceptible in terms of the change from the plans that I have been briefed on. An advance refundable tax credit means that you would basically have a document which you would take to your insurer, whether it's a CDPHP or an MVP or a Fidelis or United Healthcare, you would take that paper to them and say, here is my advance refundable. In other words, you don't have to wait till you file your income taxes. You don't have to wait. You don't have to have a tax liability with an advanced refundable tax credit.
But if he's earning $13,000 a year,
yeah.
What kind of refund is he going to get?
I'm
not understanding.
No,
how
okay.
That would work.
So you would. It does not. A advance refundable credit is not paid when you pay your taxes or you file your income tax return. The term advance means you get it right away when you want to buy the insurance.
But it's a minimal amount.
Well, no, it would be an amount that would permit him to purchase at his income level a similar type plan to what he has. And the credit, when we say refundable tax credit, if someone has typically if the, you talk about a tax credit, you need income tax liability to write it off against. A refundable tax credit, even if you have zero tax liability, you still get paid the amount of money by the government. So you would, I think the concept of a advanced refundable tax credit to defray your costs for purchasing insurance is very, very comparable to the premium support. So I don't see that as being markedly different in this regard. Some of the big areas where I see there's going to be a difference is in some of the insurance regulatory requirements that were in the ACA that have actually made it more expensive for many small businesses to purchase insurance. So the, on the good side, I started to say the good side about the pre-existing conditions and kids on their parents' policy till 26 and providing greater access for people through the exchange with the premium support. On the bad side is that the many millions of people, particularly the small business community, had their premiums skyrocket under the ACA, and many individuals who had coverage wound up with higher premiums and much higher deductibles. So I ran into a woman a few months ago who works for United Healthcare in Kingston, who told me that her deductible now, and she works for the insurance company, is now $6,000. And she said, if someone in our family, if we really get sick, we're not going to be able to pay that deductible. So part of the reason for this have been some of the insurance requirements that were put in the ACA that frankly have raised costs for people that already had insurance. So what we're trying to do is preserve what works and fix what doesn't.
Sit down and you'll be recognized.
I'm going to be respectful.
Okay.
No. Hi, my name is Lisa Lindsley, and I'm the founder of Karma Capital, which does capital markets advising to nonprofits. I'm really concerned that the premiums have skyrocketed because the insurance companies are taking advantage of the ACA to raise their rates, and it's not connected, really. The ACA didn't cause that. But what the ACA did was widen the pool so that people with pre-existing conditions were able to get coverage. I'm also concerned, I'm 52, not getting any younger, that the ACA, prohibits discrimination and higher rates, higher premiums based on gender and age. And I'm concerned that if the ACA is repealed, that those protections will go away.
Well, actually, the ACA does prohibit discrimination based on gender, and I support that provision. The ACA, though, made a mistake in terms of how, and this is, goes to the core of how premiums are actuarially decided and determined. They made a mistake when they came up with age banding of 3-to-1, which basically, and there is discrimination based on age in the ACA now. Basically, 3-to-1 age banding says that you can't charge a 60-year-old more than 3 times what you charge a 20-year-old. When we were in the budget committee just a few weeks ago, we had liberal and conservative experts, and I listened to, for 2.5 hours, I listened to the testimony. Unfortunately, when you sit in these hearings, you realize your colleagues, Democrat and Republicans, take their 5 minutes, and they tend to pontificate for 3.5 or 4 minutes, and then they ask a question. And it's not all that fulfilling. So what struck me at the hearing, though, was these experts all referred to some of the insurance regulatory aspects that need to be repaired and fixed in the ACA, one of which was age banding. All of them said age banding should be 5-to-1, not 3-to-1. In New York State, by the way, if you're in a state-regulated plan, anyone who tried to buy a coverage in the individual market in New York State before the ACA, it was not unusual to find you were paying premiums of $3,000, $4,000 in the individual market. New York completely wrecked its individual market because we have no age banding at all in New York State. In 1992, when this was enacted, I vociferously fought this in the state legislature. Because I knew, and my theory was at the time, proven to be correct, that it would wreck the individual market. We had literally only by the time 2010, 2009, we had literally only about 10,000 people in all of New York State in the individual market because New York State had wrecked it. So age banding is something that needs to happen because think about what the premise of the ACA was this. We would get all of these young people who are healthy and feel they're invulnerable, etc. At, you know, when they're 20, you at 52 and me at 64 know that that's not true. But the fact is that's what young people think. If you don't allow the young people to buy the insurance with a proper age banding of, say, 5-to-1, there will not be enough young people to come into the pool, young, healthy people, to buy insurance to make the insurance pools actuarially sound so that you can have reasonable premiums for everyone else. So it's a critical piece of the insurance regulatory design that we fix this age banding within the ACA because 3-to-1 is not wide enough, and that's why we have 7.5 million people or 6.5 million people this year who have paid the penalty, who have paid the fine. Most of them are the young, healthy ones who simply won't buy the insurance with the mandate. And so age banding is something that critically has to be adjusted, and I think it may be adjusted administratively by HHS, or it may take a statute that we have to change in order to do it. I think it may take the statute.
I just want to make sure I understood your answer, because to me it sounds like you're saying we need more discrimination in premiums, and we need to allow more differential pricing and charging older people even higher rates relative to younger people.
Lisa, you could say more discrimination. It's like saying, all of us drive cars, we all own cars, we all have car insurance. If you have a great record, no accidents, you've never had an accident that's your fault, and you're a safe driver, you have a better chance of a lower premium than someone that had a couple of accidents, that had some moving violations, that was a more reckless driver, okay? That is the way insurance is priced and analyzed actuarially on auto insurance. And in health insurance, it is actually no different. We know actuarially that someone who's 40 to 60 has higher medical costs than someone who is 20. And the notion that you can charge, that you will get all the 20-year-olds in the pool if you charge them the same as you charge someone that's 60 is not true. It doesn't work that way. Talk to anyone who does health insurance actuarial work, and they'll tell you that unless you have these distinctions based on age, not gender, but based on age, you will not be able to get enough young people in the pools. This is why you're seeing health insurers all over the country drop out of the ACA, and it's putting in jeopardy the ability of many of these insurers to actually provide the coverage because they can't price it in a satisfactory way. And it's not because, you know, there's something in the ACA which I support called medical loss ratio, MLR, medical loss ratio. They have to, by law, put 85% of all the premiums they get into health benefits. And that is a very kind of strict process for that to happen. So I'm not here defending the insurers. I'm just telling you, if you want to have a system that will work on an actuarial basis, you have to have a revised age banding within the statute in order for it to work. And if the point is, you're seeing all of these large insurers all across the country come out of the plans in large part because of this very feature in the ACA. And you're also seeing those 6.5 million people, young, healthy ones, not buying coverage precisely because it's overpriced for them.
Okay, we're broadcasting this on Facebook Live. I'd like to take one question from somebody that's watching. Put my glasses on. It's from Joanna Hartel. We are worried about our environment and the tax on the EPA and other client denying bills that are going through Congress. Will you pledge to protect the environment and to vote against fracking and oil pipelines through our counties in New York.
Well, on the environment, I support the resolution that Chris Gibson originated last year or 2 years ago, and it's being reintroduced. I'm a co-sponsor of that about the need for recognition that man-made activity does contribute to climate change. And I just recently voted against one of the Congressional Review Act regulations, which would have repealed an Obama regulation that came in at the last minute on methane emissions. I voted against it. It passed anyway, but I did vote against it. So I was also noted that the new administrator of the EPA, I know that the environmental advocates were strongly against him, but it was interesting. He was confirmed last week or the week before. And this past Saturday, there was a long interview with him in the Wall Street Journal in which he specifically talked about the need to address pollution in the Hudson River. And I thought that was a very encouraging sign. So I'm looking forward to speaking with him about that issue. So happy to do that.
Thank you. Nisha Richardson, we spoke before.
Yes.
And I had to drive over from Dutchess County. Happy to do it because I would love to have you at a town hall more locally. And in Kingston on Friday, there will be one, I'm sure you're aware. But let me pivot on a question that I asked you one-on-one is, will you support an investigation of Russia's influence on the administration, the federal administration?
Yes, absolutely.
Good.
I mean, I think that the Russian influence, the Russian attempt to influence the election, however ham-handed it may have been, was clearly wrong. But I would also point out to you that the Russians have been doing this for generations. In fact, they are right now attempting to influence the German election against Angela Merkel for reasons that Putin and Merkel are really at odds on a whole host of issues. Putin is attempting to play a very weak hand. Russia is a basket case economically. With the decline of oil prices in the last 3 years, it is even worse. And so Putin is trying to play a very weak hand in a very aggressive fashion. And I think we have to be very strong supporters of NATO. We have to support the Baltic states in terms of Russian aggression there. And I think we have to, frankly, be stronger in terms of Russian aggression in the Ukraine. But I would remind people, and this came out when the KGB, when the Soviet Union fell, and the KGB files were opened. The Russians were the main funders of the nuclear freeze movement in Europe and the United States in the early 80s. You remember that issue? The U.S. was going to deploy Pershing II missiles
Start
Treaty came about after that, Eric, but the Russians were deploying SS-20s, the U.S. deployed Pershing IIs, so you had the nuclear freeze movement in Western Europe in particular, and a lot of my friends on the left ignore this. The Russians paid the people in the nuclear freeze movement to activate in Western Europe and in the United States against the United States interest. And all I'm saying about this is that the Russians have been doing this for years. They will continue to do it. And you know what really worries me? And I heard this at the Harvard seminar that I had gone to. If you think about the North Korean cyber attack on Sony, the North Koreans came within 3 days of taking down Sony and basically destroying that company. Here's a country where one-third of the people have electricity. And yet they have the capacity to send cyber terrorists into a third country, I think it was Singapore or Malaysia, and they were able to hack into business enterprises that had relationships with Sony, and with that they were able to disgorge all of this embarrassing information about Sony and the emails, and everyone kind of laughed and twittered about it. But the fact is, the North Koreans, the Chinese, the Russians, and other bad actors, state-controlled actors, are attempting to influence not only government policy, but they're attempting to destroy the many of our leading companies and not-for-profit organizations. And we've really got to be careful about their cyber attacks on our financial institutions, on our utility grid, etc., because this is an extraordinarily dangerous and damaging thing. And we need frankly, we need to be much more vigilant about this going forward. But yeah, I think the intelligence committees of the Congress, House and Senate, Democrat and Republican, should fully investigate it. I think the Intelligence Committee is the appropriate place to do it because I'm afraid that it will touch on sensitive national security information that we don't want. And I can tell you also, the worst thing you can do is give some of these members of Congress a platform where they can pontificate in the media and go on their favorite shows and everything like that. This is so sensitive and so serious. It has to be done in the intelligence committees because those members, Democrat and Republican, are much more sensitive about keeping the secrets of our country and sensitive information than some other members. So I think it's really important that it be done, but that it be done in a smart way through the intelligence committees.
I want to go back to healthcare for a bit and just. I want to give a little context, right? Sullivan County was recently rated by the University of Wisconsin Robert Wood Johnson Foundation as 61 out of the 62 counties in New York State as the 61st healthiest, the second most unhealthy county in the state.
I know.
Right? And there's more than 250,000 people in New York State who get Medicaid through
the expansion,
the Affordable Care Act.
Yes.
And there's been all this discussion on the right about basically transforming Medicaid into a block grant. And we talked about this briefly actually over at our table. And one of the main issues is that they're going to try to take this block grant, and while they're going to start it maybe in 2017 or in a later year, maybe 2018, they're going to probably grow the rate of growth of the Medicaid spending at a lower rate than the actual amount of spending is going, which basically means that either people have to be either kicked off of Medicaid or the states and local governments have to put in more and more money. And while you said here that you're going to make sure that the growth of the block grant is not chained just to basic inflation but actually chained to healthcare expenditures, would you commit, if that is not the case, and if the Congressional Budget Office comes out and says in 10 years, 20 years, we're going to see very large losses in the in federal funding of Medicaid. Will you vote against that?
Well, I'm not going to make a commitment on a bill I haven't seen. So I would have to actually see it and weigh all the pros and cons because, frankly, this is going to be a process where a lot of the things may not be satisfactory to me. Some of the things may be satisfactory. So we have to gauge it at that point. I will also point out one of the things Speaker Ryan has said, and I agree with him about this, that we are not going to do what Nancy Pelosi did, which is to say we're going to pass a 2,200-page bill and we've got to pass it to find out what's in it. We're going to go through the regular order of the congressional hearing process, et cetera, to do it so that people know. Now, you raise a good point about the block grant. It should be tied to medical inflation. There should be a tie to medical inflation, not just the CPI generally. It's like a lot of seniors complain to me about the Social Security COLA, and that should rather, in my view, be tied to a market basket that that depends upon what seniors are buying and what they're paying for, okay? But be that as it may, we have got to get control of spending in our country and entitlement spending in general. Medicaid is one of those things. But I want to see a block grant which gives more flexibility to the state. Remember, New York State in federal, state, and local dollars right now is spending about $63 billion a year on Medicaid. And there's a lot of concern about the costs of Medicaid at the state and local level. And we have, I think, 7% of the nation's population. We in New York State spend 14% of the Medicaid dollars. One other thing that is rarely noted right now, the Obama administration penalized New York State $8 billion for past misrepresentations as to claim requests from the federal government to the state. And the state is paying a penalty every year back to the federal government, $8 billion over about 10 years. And this was done under the Obama administration because, and this is the problem that all of us in New York State have when we're dealing with Washington on Medicaid. And I'm talking about all of the representatives outside of New York versus the Democrat and Republican representatives within New York. We are viewed as kind of a bad actor when it comes to Medicaid spending. And part of it is because of things like this fine or penalty that the Obama administration proposed. So, long story on Medicaid, I want to be able to preserve the people that are in the expansion. Now, the 260 or 80,000 people you mentioned, the states were given an incentive to go into this expansion to go for people between 138% and 200% of poverty. A lot of these are single adults. So, the Medicaid expansion was paid for 90% by the federal government. The normal federal share for Medicaid in New York State is 50%. Invariably, I can tell you, based upon the financial stresses that are going on now in the federal government with the federal budget, that 90% was not going to stay. That 90% was going to go down to whatever the federal reimbursement rate is. So, I want to see us, this is how my ideal of how to transform this would be, that we have a base year that's based upon where we are now, our spending now, that we try to move through tax credits and other efforts, move many of those Medicaid people into private insurance so they're off Medicaid, and at the same time recognize that the federal reimbursement was likely to come down to 50% regardless.
It's statutorily prohibited from coming down. The ACA requires it in perpetuity. Yeah. To get 90% of the expansion for Group 8 Medicaid expansion. That's the law.
That's the law. Law enacted by Congress, which can be changed by Congress.
But why are you changing it? I don't understand.
No. What I'm suggesting to you is that the costs of this expansion were not in perpetuity going to be borne 90% by the federal government. It just was not going to happen. And I'm just giving you the realist.
Unless you change it, it won't.
If the federal government goes broke, then we're not going to be in a good position
Medicaid cost growth is the lowest of any healthcare system. If you're going to private health insurance,
okay.
You can look at the Congressional Budget Office on this issue. I can give you the report, right? It's the lowest rate of inflation of any healthcare sector, whether that's Medicare, whether that's government, VA spending, or whether that's private insurance. So it's going to cost us more money to put people onto private insurers, or we're going to have less people covered. I don't understand. Are you going to advocate for the well-being of your constituency, or what the GOP wants to do in the House? I don't understand how this helps the 19th District, which has really serious public health problems.
We have very serious public health problems, but we also have serious financial and economic problems. And what I'm suggesting to you is that the trend line in terms of those Medicaid expenditures was not sustainable. So we've got to find
the lowest of any healthcare.
The trend line is not sustainable in Medicaid. We're going to be at, in 10 years, over $1 trillion in spending just on Medicaid. By 2027, we're going to spend more on interest on the debt than we're spending on national defense. So these trends are not simply sustainable, and that's why my fundamental premise is that both in the campaign and now is we've got to get more economic growth so that more people have opportunity, so that more people buy lactose-free ice cream, so that more people buy our dairy products, etc. We've got to do all of those things. But I'm suggesting to you, in very, very candidly, that 90% reimbursement was never going to be sustainable because the finances of the system were not viable. But I'm trying to make sure that we transition. If we go to a block grant, we go to a block grant that gives New York credit for everything we're spending now so that we can preserve and defend those folks for as long as we can sustain them and try to transition them into better paying jobs, etc., and into private insurance, which I think in the long run it will be better for them.
Okay, Robert.
So here in Sullivan County, two of our big challenges to bring the county back are lack of tourism and the poor condition of our downtowns and main streets. So, I think it's important to talk about it, that we might have 40,000 people coming on a summer weekend to Bethel Woods, and maybe 5% of them have a place to stay here, because our tourism industry imploded, like up in the Berkshires with the mills up there.
Right.
So it's something that one of the reasons why we have all these problems, why we have things that we're talking about, is because we have very little economy here.
What's the question?
So the question is, what can we do to help the downtowns and the main streets, and what can we do to try to jumpstart again some kind of tourism, even if it's a smaller scale, not the grand resorts?
Well, I think that's a great question. It is the question, and I think there's no one single answer. It has to do, I think, with, you know, why do people leave New York State? Why have, in our district, the 11 counties, every single county has lost population in the last 5 years? And why is that? There aren't the jobs, and the taxes are too high. I mean, we're in a vicious cycle that we've got to reverse. So I think, frankly, changes have to happen from a regulatory standpoint in Albany that make it less expensive for people to run businesses. We are the 50th state in the nation in terms of being business friendly. That is not a sustainable model. But also at the federal level, we're going to be talking about tax reform. One of the big proposals that I have made that I know I'm pretty sure will be in a federal tax reform proposal, excuse me, will be to have 100% expensing, so that if a business invests in new plant, machinery, equipment, you can write off 100% of that investment in the year you make it. Not have a multi-year depreciation schedule that will, you know, less of an incentive for you to make that investment. So I don't care what it is. I'm agnostic. And I hate when government through the tax code picks winners and losers. I think that's a zero-sum game. I'm agnostic. If someone has a paperboard manufacturing like Viking up in New Paltz, and they buy a new piece of equipment or machinery, let them write 100% of it off in the year they do it. If you're in a business where you need a tractor or a new milking machine, or you need a new computer system for your office, write off 100% of it in the year you do it. That will spur economic activity. But we still have to come back to the core that just across, you know, not too far from here, Pennsylvania is a lower cost state to do business. And we have to make New York State collectively less expensive. And that's why I'm so bound and determined to take the opportunity, if we do a Medicaid statute, to end the Rockefeller 51-year mistake on the county property tax. Because it's going to be the one singular opportunity we have to do it. So when I ran for governor against Eliot Spitzer, some of you may not remember that, 2006, I did that. And it was only in 2009 that I got the arrows out of my head. But, you know, the fact is, one of the things that I proposed, not consolidating school districts, but consolidating all the administrative functions within school districts. Our county, Columbia County, we have 6 school districts, 6 school superintendents, 6 business managers, 6 transportation administrators, 5 food service managers. You know, the overhead in New York State to run the school districts is enormous. Now, the governor plays this game. He says, oh, we have 10,000 units of local government. We don't. Everyone knows that we have 3,400 units of local government. He's counting all these special purpose districts, like a lighting district, which is funded by the people that benefit from the lights. But there's no new government that does that. So we have too much government in New York State, though. We have too many redundancies. 60% of our property tax goes to schools. We all support education, but we shouldn't support overly expensive education either. So one of the things I'd like to see at the state level, I'd like to see counties have an option to consolidate all the administrative functions in their districts so you can preserve your local sports teams and your local identity in your local jurisdiction, but consolidate the redundancies, the administrative overhead that, frankly, is costing us too much money.
Hi. I had a couple questions. I just do one on the Medicaid. Like, I work with seniors, and New York State has a wonderful Medicaid program that actually covers senior home care. And somebody turns 65 in this country every 10 seconds. We are facing a massive boom in the aging population.
Yeah.
We're not going to need to contract Medicaid. We're going to need to continue to support that. If you cut money, people are going to be stuck at home with no care. So I just want you to keep that in your mind when you're thinking about this stuff. But my main thing that I want to ask is, we've had a lot about health care, and I feel like I'm not going to fundamentally agree with a lot of your answers. So I hope that you take into heart what my friend James over here said. at the end of the day, when you vote your conscience and you vote with the well-being of all of us in mind. Yeah, my question is this, and it was raised earlier. So I appreciate that you are so excited. It's great. Feels good to know that when you go to the Capitol, you feel joy. What I would hope is that you're carrying the hopes and dreams and wishes of all of your constituents. And while it's, I appreciate coming to this and a few other sort of events that are for pay, I want to see you hold town halls. It's a long tradition on recess.
Is there a question?
You come home, you have a hearing. I just listened to another New York State Republican, Reed, who was talking about town halls. It's part of democracy. You listen to your constituents.
Yeah.
Will you commit to having town halls in a number of the parts? You have a huge district. Open, free, open to the public town halls where you can hear from your constituents.
Yeah, I let me tell you, I'm doing meetings. I'm doing small group meetings. I'm doing larger meetings. But the town hall model is not one that it really is intended to gather information and elicit information from people. Look at what's happening around the country. There's shouting and screaming sessions. I don't find that a productive use of people's time. And there's no doubt also that there's an organized effort, and we've seen this stuff on the internet, where they're telling people how to sit in the town hall and how to ask the questions and make sure you don't carry a sign in because you won't get called. This is an organized political effort. I've been around politics long enough to know what it is, but I'm meeting, for instance, I've met with the Home Care Association to talk about home care issues. I meet with the hospitals. I meet with the nursing homes. I meet with seniors and veterans and people who are concerned about various aspects of the ACA. I get better information, in my view, understanding this precise issue that someone has. What is their situation? Where are they getting their health insurance now? How much is it costing them? How do they receive it? Are they receiving a premium support? Are they getting any subsidy whatsoever? Are they on the Medicaid portion? And I'm also talking to a lot of small businesses who tell me the ACA has priced them, they're pricing them out of the market. So what I'm trying to do is reconcile all these divergent opinions, listening to what everyone says, to come to a solution that's going to be best for all of us. And but I think this, from my experience, this is the best way that I can actually gather the information that you would want me to have. And I've seen around the country the way the town halls have been conducted. They're not productive, and no one believes that they're productive.
I would just argue that what you're seeing then is select groups of people in various organizations or organizational settings. There's a huge amount of people who aren't organized into any other setting that you're missing their input. And you represent everyone in the district, and a town hall, I mean, you don't know. You haven't done one here, so you don't know what's going to happen.
And let me also tell you,
I would argue that you try and really listen to
everybody. Let me also tell you this. I have literally responded to thousands of letters and emails. I've responded to thousands of phone calls personally and with my staff. And, you know, we're trying to balance all of these different interests. Look, I understand there's a lot of controversy. The new administration and the new president drives a lot of people to distraction. I understand all of that. But I'm doing the best that I can to fairly represent everyone and to respond to their concerns. And when someone gives me some substantive information about what their situation is, or the group or entity or the association that they represent, when they give me that substantive information, I find that much more valuable than someone getting up shouting at a town hall forum.
Okay, wait. There's other people with questions. Let's move on. Sandra, you want to ask?
Sure. Well, it was very nice to hear you briefly mention your friends to the left. My name is Sandra Oxford. I hope to become one of them.
Good.
Okay.
Well, you're already to my left, and I consider you a friend.
Okay. I just signed up on your congressional website to receive your email information because I want to get to know more about you. It's good to hear some of your positions here. I would imagine it may be somewhat awkward as a freshman congressman, though you seem very seasoned, voting against and going against your party line vote. But I think that right now with this administration and how quick this administration is moving, this district really requires somebody to be assertive and maybe even to bring along other Republicans with them. And I'm just going to ask the question. It's no secret to anybody that I'm an advocate for immigrant workers' rights. For lack of a better way to say it, with the current climate and this administration, with Muslim bans and Mexican walls and potential ICE raids and these 11-page
documents that people seem to have to put together to round up immigrant people, which I'm glad was trashed. In my work, I work with doing relief work in union places where ICE comes in and takes people. I've always had the peace of mind that I've been able to come home here where the immigrant and the undocumented people are the underpinning of the business community. Because when you look at the food processors, when you look at the agricultural community, when you look at everything, when you're talking about a clean toilet, washing a dish, I can guarantee you 90% of the people who are doing that are undocumented immigrants.
What's the question?
We have not heard from you on this issue. This is something that is very concerning. We would like a meeting in the 19th Congressional District on this issue with you.
Happy to meet with you. Number two, I stated very clearly after the president issued that executive order that it was deeply flawed and it brought about chaos and it was badly considered and badly executed and was legally flawed. There's no doubt in my mind, based upon reading of the statute and history, that a president, like Obama and Bush did most immediately before President Trump, that a president has the ability to restrict immigration from certain designated places for certain designated reasons. And I understand that there's going to be a new executive order, which I'm understanding, I haven't seen it yet, is more finely tailored. Now, I'm very concerned about the ability of our farmers and some of our food processors to bring in agricultural workers. And I'm very concerned, and I said right during the campaign that I thought we should normalize the status of people who are in the country, presuming that they have not broken any law and that they pay a penalty, etc. I don't believe that's a path to citizenship, because I think citizenship means you got to go behind the line with everyone else that's following the law. If you didn't follow the law, I don't have a lot of sympathy in terms of giving you an advantage on citizenship. But I do think that our economy in this region heavily depends on being able to bring migrant workers into our district. I went to this past Sunday, I went to 12:30 Mass at a neighboring parish of mine in Columbia County, which is Hispanic Mass,
okay.
Catholic.
Oh, Catholic?
Yeah.
No, I know the Episcopalians did a lot because you had raids in your backyard. There were people detained, and I've been communicating with the Episcopalians.
So I hadn't heard about that. But the bottom line is that I want to make sure that we fix the immigration system. I think ultimately that's really what we should do. And I am very much a supporter of being able to the free flow of agricultural workers and production workers, and these are extraordinarily good people by and large. You commit a crime, I don't have any sympathy for you. I don't think, and you know, the folks that I talked with after church on Sunday, they said to me, we don't have any sympathy for someone that commits a crime.
I just
either.
Want to say one thing, because my sheriff is here, and I've been in rooms with our sheriff with undocumented immigrants, and the undocumented immigrants are the first people to remind everyone that those criminal-minded individuals are preying on them first.
Exactly.
And they don't want them here either.
Yeah, I understand.
Okay.
Be happy to meet with you. Talk to Ryan right afterwards, and we'll set that up.
There's another question from Facebook Live. Pat Sprout from Delhi wants to know where you stand in funding college education.
Well, the federal government has a major role in this regard. I'd like to see, frankly, I'd like to see the FAFSA form, the FAFSA federal free financial aid, whatever that FAFSA form is called. It's been a few years since I filled it out for my kids. I'd like to see those aid programs consolidated and made simpler. And I'd also like to see a process whereby the colleges would actually tell the students before they enroll what the prospect is that they're going to get a job in a particular major that they may be receiving from that higher education institution. And I think we also need to have more vocational and skills training to train people to be carpenters and electricians. And up at Hudson Valley Community College, I've gone through their system. They have a robotic training program which teaches students how to operate robotic design equipment And these people don't become robotic machinists. They become the people that teach other people to become robotic designers. And it's a really burgeoning business. Every single kid of the 150 that graduates from that program every year has a job before they leave. We could have 100 of these facilities around the country. And so I'm trying right now to get talk to the Appropriations Committee to have more funding for these kind of technical skills training in robotics and high value manufacturing, which is really a great avenue for kids that don't want to go and get a 4-year degree.
Alan Swanson.
Hey, Alan. Murray,
thank you for being here.
Yeah.
Question I have gets back into healthcare. The United States is one of only two countries that allow direct-to-consumer advertising of pharmaceutical products. And I think one of the big reasons for the health crisis is that we have all these pharmaceutical companies pushing on television, through magazines, all these drugs. I think a lot of these drugs are just drugs that didn't work for one thing, so they create a new disease to market it to people. And so, you know, that we only became the second country to do it. The other country is New Zealand. In the late 90s, when then-President Clinton signed the FDA rule, that allowed direct-to-consumer advertising of pharmaceutical products. Will you, through Congress, revisit that rule? And what I'd like to see is the repeal of that FDA rule, so that these pharmaceutical products aren't marketed directly to consumers. Because the way these commercials are run, they basically give you a list of symptoms to go to your doctor with so you can get medicine. And that's exactly what's happening. I think it's one of the biggest things behind the health crisis in this country. And I think it's something that Congress needs to go back and revisit and hopefully repeal that rule so that these pharmaceutical companies aren't marketing directly to consumers.
Does everyone on Facebook hear the question? That's why I just had a...
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay. So the question about direct-to-consumer pharmaceutical advertising, I've long been skeptical of it myself. I think probably changing it would invite a firestorm from the people who benefit from that, not just the pharma companies, but the ad agencies and the media companies that get the money from it. But I do think, you know, you may have noticed, look, the opioid crisis, as the sheriff and undersheriff can tell you, the opioid crisis is just pervasive throughout our communities. And the free accessibility of opioid pharmaceuticals is such that now they actually have an ad on TV saying that if you have opioid-induced constipation, you can get this new drug to counteract the effects of the opioids that you may be taking. I mean, I really think that the country is over-medicated in a lot of ways. I don't pretend to be an expert on this, but I do think that from an early age, we may be over-medicating a lot of our citizens, and I think there really needs to be a review of it. There's no doubt that a lot of the kids go into opioids because they think, oh, it's FDA approved, it's safe, and then they find out they can't afford it, and that's the path to heroin. And we see fentanyl and laced heroin as well, which is a killer. So you raise a good point. I don't have an answer for you on that. I haven't researched it or studied it with people in D.C., but it's something I will look at, Alan.
All right, I appreciate that.
I think we've run out of time. It's been over an hour.
We have a couple more.
You're okay
two
with
more,
it?
Two more. Two more. I'll be brief.
I'm Barbara Clapper. I'm just a retired finance and accounting professional who lives up here. Yesterday, Vice President Pence was asked a question by the European, I think it was a BBC guy. Who do we believe? Do we believe what comes out of Trump's mouth? Or do we believe what comes out of people like you? You know, our representatives, our senators. Because it's causing a tremendous amount of, I mean, I'm 60 years old, okay? I have never been so frightened in my life to have this, what I consider a lunatic as a president. It's not about politics. It's not about Democratic, Republican, left, right, pink, yellow, purple. This man's a pathological liar. He lies about everything and anything.
What's the question, Mark?
So how could we as constituents of you, of our senators, how could, who are we supposed to listen to? Just like Vice President Pence was asked that question. Who are we supposed to listen to?
Well, let me say thank you for that question.
Oh, and one more thing, can I just say, your staff is wonderful.
Okay.
I called your office, and
thank
they're one of the best staffs I've seen.
Thank you. Well, I mean, I can say that I speak for myself, and I hope that you understand that I'm trying to fairly consider the viewpoints of people. I have my own points of view. I'm often told that I'm wrong, particularly when I'm home with my wife, when I get home on that Friday night.
And,
yeah, but the bottom line is I think that the would be better off if high officials weren't tweeting about matters of state.